Hello, thank you for watching Urban Television. On the show tonight, or today, we have with us Pastor Nicholas Wafula. He's one of the most renowned churchmen in Uganda and the East African region. And we'll continue the conversation as we had previously, on the previous edition, we talked about the start of the Deliverance Church in Uganda and his contribution to leadership. But today, we want to focus on family and marriage. This is one of the most, you know, crucial topics lately in the country. There is concern, perhaps, that, you know, marriages are not working as they should be, and families are getting more and more dysfunctional. So we want to pick on Pastor Wafula's mind and see what he thinks of marriage and family today. So welcome to the show, Pastor. If we may start.
Thank you.
What is your description of, let's start with marriage. What is it to you?
To me, it's what the Bible says, that in the Garden of Eden, God caused the man to sleep, and eventually, out of the rib of the man, God made a woman, and we end up with Adam as the man and Eve as the woman. And as we normally say sometimes at the wedding ceremonies, that in the Garden of Eden, God was the only person there. He did all the celebration of wedding Adam and Eve together. So that's my understanding of marriage, is a husband who is and a wife who is female.
And what is your understanding of family?
Family?
Yes. How would you best describe it to anyone?
Well, family is a unit, of course, which begins with two. That is husband and wife. And then you bring in family. You begin with the children. And in many ways, as Christians, you don't only stop at the children. You might find that you have to include some spiritual children. And so, and then we live in a culture which believes in extended family, so that when you're talking about family, it's something bigger than just your children.
What is the family like today?
Well, as I can say that I met, she wasn't then a queen, but we had fellowships in Kampala when I moved in. Mainly 71, 72, we used to attend Scripture Union conferences or fellowships. There's what we used, I think it is still there, Uganda Hospital Christian Fellowship, because she was doing nursing, and that's how I was able to support her.
Mm. What stood out? What stood out? Because I believe you're in a in a group of many people.
Yes.
What
made she wasn't even special? A member of our church. She was from a different congregation. We just met in the fellowships, mm-hmm. which brings everybody together. One was the person. Okay. Elizabeth as a person, as a lady. She was a lady who hit my heart, not just my eye, but even hit my what? My heart. I don't know how I can describe it. But then, because we were young people, so when this started, I whispered it to some of my friends. I said, what do you think about this one? And I said, man, you have a hit on it. Let's see how it goes. Mm-hmm. So gathered the courage and I launched. And it was not very easy, but eventually we got married. Mm-hmm. And one of the problems we had right from the start was I was a Pentecostal. She was Anglican. Her father was even an archdeacon. So the thing that had we had to work on. If we produce children, where do we take them? I said, okay, you'll be going to Pentecostal church, and I go and I said, no, that can't work. I refused. I don't think I need to get into the details of what happened, but eventually she went and shared with her father, and the father didn't have any problem with her getting married from Pentecostal. So on the 28th of April 1973, we became the second couple in Deliverance Church to get married.
Second couple?
The second couple.
Who was the first?
Pastor Stephen Mungoma.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, interesting. So you say it wasn't easy for you to get her hand in marriage. What was the difficult part?
It was basically seeing us with the children and wondering, where do children belong? Do they belong to the go to Pentecostal church with the father, or they go to the Anglican church with what? The mother. And I just personally felt that can't work. And actually we called it off until God had to perform a miracle to make her come back.
And what miracle is that?
The miracle is that I supervised a team from Uganda to go and attend the Deliverance Church conference in Mombasa. Mm-hmm. And from her side, I think there was an Anglican meeting of nurses somewhere in Nairobi, almost the same time. But when she reached Nairobi, she found that their conference had been changed or abandoned. So a friend of hers who was a member of the Deliverance Church persuaded her, said, why can't we go to Mombasa for a Deliverance Church? Go, now that you're here, why do you go back? Let's go. She accepted and she went. And of course, the preacher there talked about baptism in the Holy Spirit, which she had already been. Talked about baptism in water, that was her hardest thing. But eventually she was baptized by immersion in the Indian Ocean. And I think that is what changed her life. And from there, she came and told her father that I'm going to marry what? A Pentecostal.
Because she had become born again.
Yeah, and not just born again. But I think that baptism in water changed her around. Because by the time we started talking together, she was already born again. Actually, she has been a Christian longer than me.
Oh.
Yes.
So what would we call this baptism? Is it some sort of reawakening? What is it?
There's a power in it. I can't describe it. There's a power. Yeah. If you remember, John the Baptist did it. Jesus himself did it. You remember that when Jesus came out and God spoke? Say, this is my son in whom I'm well pleased. So some people use this baptism just like a play game. There is actually power in being baptized in water.
Well, before we even go any further, I'm still going to take you back to when you first saw Queen and you're like, this is the person I'm going to marry. Because even then you called your friends and said, is she the one? You must have seen something, because we want maybe the young people of today to learn how it was done back then and what is being done today, because things are changing. So what was that outstanding thing about Queen that made you say?
I said her beauty, her behavior, those two.
Beauty, you want to describe it for us? What was this beauty like?
I cannot describe it, but I thought she was just the right person for me. And I was imagining if I took her home, they would readily accept her, even when she was not from my tribe. So,
What tribe is she from?
She's a Mugwere.
Oh, okay. From?
And I'm a Samia.
Oh. Those are two, they're quite close, I would think, the languages?
No.
Or there is a huge difference?
There's a difference, not a huge difference, but the only thing is that they are Bantu languages. That's all.
Okay. So what was the secret for you guys to make this marriage, you know, stay on for these 50 years?
There are many ways I can say it, but the only thing that I can say is it was because of both of us being Christians and allowing Jesus to be at the center of our lives and being at the center of the home. Ecclesiastes says that a three-stringed cord cannot easily be broken. So there was Elizabeth here, and there was Nicholas here, and in between is Jesus. And it is Jesus who has kept us together. Of all these years, there have been moments of joy, there have been moments of sorrow. As I mentioned earlier, there's a time my wife lost both parents within a period of a year, and that was quite tough. But we stuck with one another. And I think if you have the love of God in your life, I think the love will just flow out to your spouse, and it will flow out to your children, and it will flow out to anybody you get in touch with it. So our survival, if you want, if we have to give glory to anything or to anybody, is the Lord Jesus living in us.
So beyond Jesus, there should have been more. What other things were you doing around yourselves that
I've already mentioned
strong,
loving one another.
Yes.
And I want to say we're not angels. we have had loud talks. Okay? We have had loud talks. But I want to say I have not taken this hand for the last 50 years and laid them on Elizabeth suddenly. Not even the fivefold ministries falling on her suddenly, because that is not what these hands are supposed to do. That would be another story altogether if you want to describe what these hands are supposed to do. Between a husband and a wife. They are supposed to make them feel nice, not to make them feel pain.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So for 50 years, I have not done that. Not because she's an angel. Not because I'm an angel. It is all because of Jesus. And the other thing, which is very common, we injure one another. And we should be ready to forgive one another. There are men who would find it difficult to say, I'm sorry. Okay? Okay? I personally feel when I realize that I've made a mistake to my wife, even to my children, I have to say, I am sorry for what I have done. Because we are not angels. We make mistakes. And that was another aspect of our lives. As we have lived together, we have loved Jesus, loved one another, determined that we shall forgive one another when we injure one another.
Interesting. You mentioned how you say most men find it so difficult to say...
No, let me change my sentiment. Some men
find it difficult, okay, to say sorry. So how did you get yourself into that space where you actually say sorry, if you must say sorry, whether you're wrong or right, you just want to say sorry?
Sometimes you can say sorry even when you know you are right, but you want to keep the relationship with your spouse.
Uh-huh.
And if you read my first book, Jesus in Your Tears, that's my second book. Yeah, Jesus in Your Tears. I take the life of Jesus all the way to the cross. And when he was on the cross, he cried and said, Lord, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. So forgiveness is unconditional.
So I'm just curious about how you get yourself in that space, because like you said, for most people it's difficult. So how do I get myself from that rigid point of not saying sorry to actually making saying sorry a normal thing to save the marriage?
Yeah, it's just breaking. Allow yourself to break down. Okay? Be ready to be humble. Be ready to sacrifice for the sake of the others. And as I said earlier, simply because Jesus being there, he knows how to do it, and he's the one who will cause you to do it, not actually you yourself.
Well,
It is difficult to describe to you probably, but all I can say, Jesus will enable you to do it because you have decided, I'm going to live the life of Jesus. And if Jesus forgave even those people who did not ask for forgiveness, there's no reason why I cannot forgive my spouse whom I love so much.
I love how you've put it now. It's now very clear. So we shall take a break for now, and then we'll return with more of this conversation with Pastor Nicholas Wafula.